1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 through 11. And with that, why don't you stand with me and open your Bible. If you don't have one, please take the one in the chair in front of you, and you can take that home with you. That's our gift to you. But we'll read those verses and we'll pray. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1 says this, "Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received, and in which you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast that word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you, first of all, that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried, and that He rose again on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that He was seen by Cephas, and then by the 12. After that He was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain to the present, but some have fallen asleep. After that He was seen by James, then by all the apostles, then last of all He was seen by me also, as by one born out of due time. For I am the least of the apostles, who am not worthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God I am what I am, and His grace toward me was not in vain. But I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. Therefore, whether it was I or they, so we preach, and so you believed." Let's pray. Father, I thank You so much for sending Jesus for us, that He died for us, and especially that He is risen from the grave. Help us today continue to celebrate His resurrection, holding fast to it, for it is crucial to our faith. Teach us by Your Spirit, through Your Word, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. He is risen. Amen. I love that. Yes. He is risen. He is alive. So whether you call it Easter, whether you call it Pascha, whether you call it Resurrection Sunday, today all Christians everywhere celebrate the cornerstone event of our faith, the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. This is the event that proves that Jesus is the Son of God, the long-awaited King of Israel, the one who reverses the curse placed upon Adam in the Garden of Eden. This is the event that changed a minor Jewish sect in Galilee and Judea into the true faith of Christianity. This is the event upon which all of our hopes rest. That's a lot. Is that just a bunch of hype? Is that just a bunch of preacher talk that you expect to hear on Easter? Not in the slightest. The resurrection of Jesus from the dead is the foundational truth of Christianity. Without it, we have no Christianity at all. Without it, there's no gospel, there's no hope, there's no promise of life. But with it, we have everything. Christians must believe the gospel in order to be saved, and in order for the gospel to be the gospel, we need the resurrection. And that's the point that Paul drives home to the Corinthians and a letter that he wrote to them just barely 20 years after Jesus rose from the dead. The church at Corinth had a marvelous founding. It was established by Paul and Silas on Paul's second missionary journey, later strengthened by the teaching of Apollos. This church, though, quickly fell into all kinds of error. They were divisive, they were proud, they were permissive of sin, they were abusive of the spiritual gifts, and a lot more. Paul found himself needing to bring correction to this church. And he did so through his letters, and as he said in his letters, he wouldn't hesitate to do so in person either. In this particular letter, he just wrapped up an extended teaching on the proper use of the spiritual gifts, with the emphasis being that all spiritual gifts, that emphasis needs to be love, sacrificial love for one another. If love was practiced among the Corinthians, then everything else would fall into place. Worship at that point would be done decently in order they would glorify God. At this point in the letter, Paul makes a solid break. He distinctly changes topics. In previous chapters, he was writing about issues, answering questions that they had asked him and correspondence that went back and forth. But this is an issue that Paul himself introduced. He had heard of doubts among some of the church about the validity of the resurrection, and he knew this needed to be addressed ASAP. Issues like spiritual gifts are important, but they're non-essentials in regards to salvation. The resurrection, however, is vital. Again, without the resurrection, we have no gospel. Without the gospel, we have no salvation. It is that important. And so the first thing we read here is that the resurrection is foundational. We'll read in verses 1 and 2. Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received and in which you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast that word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. Now, as Paul is going to make plain, the resurrection is a core tenet of the gospel message that he received, and the gospel was the most important teaching in Paul's ministry. This is what he preached everywhere he went. He preached it once in Corinth. He declared it to them again in this letter. This is what the people at the time had already received. It was what they stood in, or at least what they were supposed to be standing in until the present day. The gospel was a message by which they were saved, meaning that without the gospel, they could not be saved. In another letter that Paul wrote to the Romans, he said the gospel is the power of God unto salvation, first to the Jew and then for the Greek, Romans 1:16. It is the power unto all aspects of our salvation, past, present, and future. Justification, sanctification, and glorification. Fancy words just meaning that the gospel is the reason that our past sins have been forgiven. It's the method by which we are currently being transformed into the image of Christ, and it is the means by which we will be able to forever stand in the presence of God in heaven. It is that important. So what is it? If the gospel is that crucial to our life in Christ, then we ought to know what it is. A lot of people say, well, did you believe the gospel without being able to explain what the gospel is? Well, the gospel is just good news. It's taken from the same Greek word, by the way, from which we get evangelism. When we evangelize, we're just telling people good news about Jesus. Okay, we know it's good news. What is the good news? What's the news? What is it that we're supposed to tell others? What is it that we're supposed to believe? Well, that's what Paul writes next when he shows us that the resurrection is historical, starting in verse 3. For I delivered to you, first of all, that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. Now, before he gets to the details, he once more emphasizes its importance. It was primary. It's primary. There's no more important task that Paul could do in a city other than to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. When he traveled in his various missionary journeys, he didn't arrive in town preaching spiritual gifts, which he just got done writing about. That's not what he first preached when he got there. He didn't meet new people and start talking about all the good works that they ought to be doing, though he talked about doing good works for the Lord. He didn't tell them how they could, you know, arrive at their best life right now and enjoy that. When Paul came to a new place, he preached the gospel, and everything else was secondary, and it is. But whether or not your home for church is Calvary Chapel Tyler, the most important thing about anywhere you worship is that the gospel of Jesus Christ is proclaimed. If you don't have that, you don't have a church. Why? Because without the gospel, no one is saved. Without Jesus being proclaimed as Lord and the message of his death and resurrection being front and center to our faith, then we have absolutely nothing. It doesn't matter how professional the worship band may sound. It doesn't matter how fancy the church building looks. It doesn't even matter how compassionate and loving the people are who attend there if the gospel is not there. Everything else, even though they may all be important things, everything else is secondary. The gospel must come first because that's the only way the Lord Jesus comes first. Now, keep in mind, this is something that Paul learned. He only delivered what it was he received. It did not originate with him, and the gospel sure didn't end with him. He was just a good steward, and he passed it along to others. And that's what all churches ought to do. By the way, for your information, the fact that Paul states here in verse 3 that he received this message of the gospel is an incredible apologetic proof to the validity of the message itself. How so? Because Paul will write of the resurrection that he was told, he saw him for himself, not just that he witnessed, but this whole creed that he's about to say, this is something he was taught. It was imparted onto him. Now remember, he's writing this letter barely 20 years after the events took place in Jerusalem, and already this was a formalized teaching being taught to others. So this is no mere rumor. This is not a legend that developed over time. There's not any time for a legend to develop here. So everything that Paul declared in his gospel is historical fact. What's involved with the gospel? Well, there's five basic elements that have been passed along to Paul, which he's now going to repeat to the Corinthians. Gospel element number one, Christ. Christ. Without Jesus, we have no gospel. But it can't just be any Jesus. It's got to be the right one. Without the right understanding of Jesus, we still have no gospel. And the first thing that we need to believe is that Jesus is the Christ. Now, granted, you know, Jesus' first name does not appear in this immediate section. In fact, Paul hasn't used the name Jesus at all since chapter 12, verse 3. But throughout the letter, he's made it clear that Jesus is the Christ. He affirms it from his opening words in chapter 1, verse 1, all the way through. And to someone who had read this letter from beginning to end, which is really the right way to read the letters in the New Testament, it's letters, you read them from beginning to end, then there would be no doubt that when Paul, by this point, used the word Christ, he was referring to Jesus. But all this begs the question, what does it mean to believe that Jesus is Christ? Well, we got to remember that Christ is not a name, it's a title. Many people assume that Jesus' last name is Christ, and his middle initial is H. But that's a misunderstanding. Christ is a title. It's the Greek I really didn't mean to say that. Is the Greek translation of the Hebrew word meaning Messiah, meaning anointed one. This is the title that the Jews used to refer to the future son of David, the king of Israel. This is the title used to refer to the person who would be the fulfillment of all the promises that God made to Abraham, Moses, David, all the prophets, the Hebrew people as a whole. Thus, Christ is a man, but he's more than a man. He's the son of God. When we proclaim Jesus as the Christ, we're proclaiming him to be God in the flesh. Now talk about crucial, because if we get this wrong, we get the whole thing wrong. Without a proper understanding of Christ, we have no gospel, and people have all kinds of ideas about Jesus that have nothing to do with him being the Son of God, but that's the very first thing we need to believe about him. That's the first gospel element. Second gospel element, Christ Jesus died for our sins. Now this is what we remembered on Good Friday. The Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, had to die for all the sin of all humanity. The only perfect man who ever lived had to be made a sin sacrifice for our sake in order that the price for our sin could be paid. The wages of sin is death, Romans 6:23, and the only one who could truly pay it is Christ Jesus. After all, if we die in our sins, then we remain dead forever. People who die in their sins without the forgiveness of Jesus don't actually die once, they die twice. They face a second death when God judges them for all eternity. So that eternal debt must be paid, and that's what Jesus did at the cross. And that was the meaning when Jesus uttered the Greek word, one single word that we translate into a whole sentence, it is finished, but he said tetelestai from the cross. This means it's finished, the work is done, the price is paid. And as Paul wrote here, Christ died for our sins. And he says this is foretold in the scripture, and we saw this on Good Friday in passages like Psalm 22, passages like Isaiah 53, go into extreme detail about the death of the Messiah. Nearly every aspect of Jesus' betrayal, suffering, and crucifixion were prophesied centuries before it ever took place. There's no excuse for someone to look at the Hebrew scriptures and not recognize Jesus as the fulfillment. The only way they can miss it is if they're spiritually blind, which, by the way, the Bible affirms many people are. So, Christ died for our sins, verse 4, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scripture. So, gospel element number 3, Christ was buried. His body was placed in the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea. And is this really a big deal? After all, if he died, surely he's buried. We think that's common sense. Well, true. But that is exactly why this is a big deal. Some might theorize, and some still do, that Jesus didn't really die on the cross. He just appeared to be dead. They say that Jesus swooned on the cross. He fainted, or perhaps he fell into a coma. Or, you know, maybe because of who he is, you know, he didn't really have true death come upon him. He just had the appearance of death. He didn't really die. Not so. Jesus really, truly died on the cross. His physical body expired, and all the signs of his death were seen by those who witnessed it. His death was even certified by one of the best experts in all Jerusalem at the time, a Roman centurion, and he knew how to kill people. And he would have faced harsh penalties, probably death himself, for lying to the governor Pontius Pilate that a man under his supervision had died, but if he lied and said, no, he lived and he didn't really die. So there's no doubt that Jesus died. And the proof was his body was laid in a tomb. Remember that his friends were the ones who buried him. formerly secret disciples, Joseph of Arimathea, Nicodemus the Pharisee. If you're taking care of your friend's body, it is inconceivable that you would bury your friend if you had the slightest hope that they were alive. The only way they would have had comfort in sealing his tomb would be if he was truly dead. So yes, Jesus' burial is a crucial part of the gospel message. It certifies his death. That brings us to gospel element number four. Christ rose again the third day. Jesus was really buried and he really rose. He who was dead came back to life. This is the specific event that we celebrate today. And again, this is what makes it the gospel. This is what makes the gospel the gospel. This is why it's good news. How so? Because even if Jesus claimed to be God, even if he still performed incredible miracles, even if he still died on the cross, he was buried in the tomb, if there was no resurrection, we would have zero proof that Jesus actually is the Christ. If Jesus died and stayed dead, he'd be no different than other prophets who came and performed miracles. Actually, in fact, he would be worse than other prophets, because even if he performed the miracles, he would have proven himself a liar. Because Jesus repeatedly said that he would rise from the grave, even saying that the resurrection would be the sign demonstrating his authority as the Son of Man. That was a sign of Jonah. Thus, if Jesus didn't rise, he'd be a liar. If he was a liar, then he couldn't do anything else he promised. If he's a liar, we can't trust anything else he said or did. So it's vital that Jesus rise from the grave as proof that he is the Son of God, and that's exactly what he did. After his betrayal, his torture, his crucifixion, Jesus died on the cross. His body's taken down, it's buried, and in 3 days he rose. He conquered death, he declared his victory over sin and Satan, and he rose a glorious new life. And because he did, we can know that everything he said was true, everything that he did was true, everything that he promises is true. And so that's why Paul goes on to write to the Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 15, 55 through 57, O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, the strength of sin is the law, but thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Our salvation is wrapped up in Jesus' resurrection. Our eternal life hinges upon his resurrected life. We have hope of erection of our own because Jesus is the first one risen from the dead. So thanks be to God that Jesus rose. In him there is total victory. Amen. By the way, what scriptures speak of Jesus' resurrection on the third day? Although the specific combination of third day resurrection is not nearly as clear-cut in the Old Testament scriptures as is the prophecies regarding his betrayal, suffering, and death, there are still several passages that point to it. We don't have time to go into them all, but just list a few off. First is one that Peter quoted on the day of Pentecost, Psalm 16:10, for you will not leave my soul in Sheol, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. So there's a fact of the resurrection of the Messiah. You've got Hosea 6:2, which speaks prophetically, typologically of the third day resurrection. After 2 days, he will revive us. The third day, he will raise us up that we may live in his sight. Then, of course, you've got the sign of the prophet Jonah, which Jesus referred to himself. Jonah 1:17, that the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow Jonah. Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. So it was like he really died in that fish. He really came back to life. That was a sign. That's a proof that Jesus is the Son of God. And that's, of course, not all. Scripture has other references to third day deliverance. Abraham's offering of Isaac, he looked up on the third day, and of course that was specifically tied to the hope of the resurrection because Abraham had faith that God could raise the dead. We see that in Genesis 22. We see the appearance of God to the Israelite nation on Mount Sinai. You know, that came on the third day, Exodus 19:11, and so much more. There's so much that sets up this expectation that the Messiah will come on the third day after death. But the bottom line is that the scripture said that Jesus would rise. Jesus himself said that he would rise, and he rose. Our God died on the cross, but he did not remain dead. Our God was laid in a tomb, but he did not stay there. He's risen, he's alive, and because he is, we have the certified promise of eternal life. Now at this point, the question might be, but how can we know? You know, we could take it as an article of faith that Jesus rose from the grave, but how can we know for sure? Well, that's the next part of the gospel that's passed along to you by Paul, verse 5, and that he was seen by Cephas, and then by the 12, and he goes off to list these others. Here's gospel element number 4. Jesus' resurrection was witnessed. It was witnessed. He was seen by multiple people from a wide variety of backgrounds and locations. Remember, the Jewish culture, Jewish law, taught that 2 to 3 witnesses were required to establish facts, particularly in regards to legal judgments. Well, in verses 5 through 8, there's far more than just a couple people. More than enough to establish the resurrection. All totaled, Paul gives 6 groupings of witnesses of Jesus' resurrection. Now, we shouldn't think that this is a comprehensive listing of all of Jesus' resurrection appearances. It actually includes some that aren't listed elsewhere. Keep in mind that not even the gospel accounts have it all. They're clear that not everything Jesus said and did is written down. All the libraries in the world aren't enough to hold the books that could be written. First witness is Peter, or as he's known by his Aramaic name here, Cephas. Now, why is Peter listed first? Because even if he was never the Pope of Rome, which he wasn't, he still had a place of preeminence among the apostles. He was the first with the grand confession that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and Jesus blessed him on account of it. Matthew 16, verses 16 and 17. Of course, Peter was also the one with one of the worst betrayals of Jesus, having denied knowing him 3 times. He had been graciously forgiven. He'd been restored by the Lord. And the fact that Peter received a special appearance from Jesus underscores that restoration. So Peter, or Cephas, they both mean the rock, not Dwayne Johnson, Peter. He would not any longer be known as the one who denied the Lord Jesus. He would be known as the one who received the grace of the Lord Jesus. That is his permanent identity. That's a grand identity. When you came to faith in Christ, believing upon him as your Lord and Savior, you became a new creation. He gave you a new identity. He gave you a new future. No longer are you the person you once were. The resurrection of Jesus changed all that. Now you are known by his grace. God sees you as his child because of the love of Jesus. That is your new identity. Remember it and praise God for it. If you still haven't surrendered your life to Christ, you're still known for your sin, but you don't have to be known that way. You also can know the forgiveness of God. Believe on the risen Christ, receive your new identity. Witness number 1 was Peter. Witness number 2 is the 12. If Paul were being a little bit more precise, he probably would have written here the 11. Because Judas had already departed the apostles when he betrayed Jesus to the Jews. But this group was known collectively, of course, as the 12, well known as the 12. And Judas' spot, by the way, was replaced, so we know this is supposed to be the 12. So he's correct in referring to him that way. Well, when did this take place? This is probably a reference to Jesus' 2 appearances to the apostles on Resurrection Sunday and the week following. In fact, his first appearance was technically to 10 apostles. Thomas wasn't with him at that time. He famously and firmly doubted the news of Jesus' resurrection until a week later. He had to wait a whole additional week in grief until Jesus appeared to the full group again the following Sunday. That's when he finally joined the rest of his brothers in faith. So he appeared to Peter, he appeared to the apostles, and somebody would object and say, well, those are apostles. We'd expect the 12 disciples of Jesus to affirm his resurrection. What if they're all conspiring together in a lie? How do we know this is true? Well, first of all, the objection's highly illogical given the circumstances. One, their Messiah had died, which takes away any supposed reason for them to proclaim Jesus as the Messiah. The Jews would have laughed them off as being foolish if Jesus was still dead. Secondly, every time the apostles proclaimed Jesus, they endangered themselves with the Jewish authorities. They had no reason to continue a conspiracy because they had nothing to benefit from it if it was all indeed a lie. And then third, eventually it wasn't just the Jews who opposed them, but the Romans. And if the disciples had been conspiring together in a lie, that would have unraveled very quickly when the hand of Rome came down upon them. People don't die. They don't receive torture for lies that they know are lies. Eventually, the truth comes out. So it is illogical with that objection. But secondly, the objection is anticipated with a third witness or group of witnesses we see in verse 6. After that, he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remained to the present, but some had fallen asleep. So witness number 3, 500 other brethren. Now, if 12 men are expected to keep a conspiracy, how do you get 500? Eventually, somebody and all that's going to crack. You can't take 2 criminals into a police station, break them up and have them keep the same story. 500 kept it. No one broke. Besides, out of those 500, you know, there were likely very few among those 500 who followed Jesus as steadfastly as the 12 apostles did during his earthly ministry. In other words, out of this 500, the majority of them were disinterested parties. They had nothing to gain from a lie about a resurrected Jesus, yet they believed in him anyway. They could testify to his resurrection. In fact, Paul counts on the fact they could do exactly that thing. Although a few had died in the past 20 years, the majority of them were still alive. And if the Corinthians doubted Paul, they doubted his testimony, then they could go ask any number of the original 500 still living at the time. They could go check out the proof for themselves. Now, obviously, we don't have that same privilege. The only time we're going to speak to the apostles or anyone who saw the physical resurrected Jesus is when we get to heaven. And then it won't matter because we'll be looking at the resurrected Jesus for ourselves. But even so, we can still speak to men and women whose lives have been transformed by the living God. Every single person in this building today who has been born again has had a real experience with the living, real Jesus. And if that's you, you can tell somebody else that Jesus is alive. How do you know? Because you met him. That's how you know. It was in faith, but you met him. You knew he was real. You knew you needed to surrender your life to him. That's my testimony. I wasn't looking for Jesus when Jesus found me, and all of a sudden I knew he's real. I doubted God was real at all, and all of a sudden I knew Jesus is the Son of God. The gospel had been preached. I wasn't looking for anything. I just showed up for a free rock and roll concert. But I knew Jesus was alive. And he was calling me to be saved. So I surrendered my life to him. You can do the same thing. If you don't have that kind of assurance about a living Jesus with whom you've interacted, you need to ask yourself, why not? You need to ask yourself some tough questions. Especially if you claim to be a born-again Christian. A born-again Christian is someone who's received new life from a living Savior. If you haven't, you haven't been born again. So today, make sure your faith is in the living Jesus. By the way, with this 500, when did this particular meeting take place? Well, we don't know for certain. The Bible doesn't say anything more about it except this one verse. Quite possibly, it was the prearranged meeting in Galilee that Jesus told the disciples about. It seems that would be a logical place for a gathering of this size because it surely would not have gone unnoticed in Jerusalem. It's a perfect place for Jesus to give the Great Commission to the church as we see in Matthew 28, 19, and 20. But in case, 500. Verse 7, after that he was seen by James and all the apostles. Witness number 4 is James. Now there's several men named James in the New Testament. Which is this? Well, more than likely, this is the half-brother of Jesus who eventually became the leader of the church in Jerusalem. Originally, none of the brothers of Jesus believed him, but something happened that transformed them from skeptics into believers. Not just believers, but leaders of the church. They even penned letters in the New Testament, James and Jude. Now, what could have happened to convince these men that their brother was the Son of God? It takes something big. I have an older brother. It takes nothing less than Jesus' resurrection from the dead. Jesus was raised. That was all the proof that they needed. And all of a sudden, now the miracles make sense. All of a sudden, now all the stories of their mom and their dad, they make sense. No longer do they see their brother as just their brother. They see their brother through new eyes. They don't look at him as just another sibling around the dinner table. They see him as the living God. That's the power of the resurrection. Witness number 5, all the apostles. You say, wait a second, the apostles were already mentioned. Well, yes and no. Technically, the 12 were mentioned, but the word apostles can refer to more than just the 12. Obviously, Paul was an apostle. There's number 13. Andronicus and Junius are mentioned among the apostles, though they're mentioned nowhere in the Gospels. Romans 16, verse 7. Barnabas is named alongside Paul as an apostle in Acts 14, 14. Now, some people make a case for Apollos being included among the apostles based on Paul's comparison with him in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and 4. But even if only the specific 12 are in mind, this can still count again because Jesus appeared to them more than once. Right? Not only were there the two occasions on the Sundays following the crucifixion, not only was a prearranged meeting in Galilee, there was the time when he appeared to them on the seashore and restored Peter to the ministry. There's the time that he had his final day that his feet sat on the planet Earth, the day of his ascension. It was then that Jesus told the disciples to go back to Jerusalem, wait for the baptism of the Holy Spirit, that they could have power to be witnesses of him to all the world. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. They were obedient. They were witnesses. We've got a list of testimony as proof that they were faithful to their divine calling. Verse 8, then last of all, He was seen by me also as one born out of due time. Witness number six, Paul. He doesn't leave himself out of the list of witnesses. He too saw the resurrected Christ. Yes, Jesus had already ascended to heaven, but Paul received a special vision of the resurrected Jesus. Now, when he say vision, we're not talking about just something in his mind, not talking about a hallucination. No, this is a true appearance of Jesus. It was witnessed by the men who were traveling with him, though they couldn't make out the distinct things of what was going on. This was a real appearance, however, even if it was different than the ones experienced by the other apostles. This is what qualified Paul as an apostle in his mind, of course, in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 1. You know, even if it was a little bit out of sync, like a prematurely born baby, Paul could personally testify to the risen Jesus, for he had seen the risen Jesus. And that's exactly what Paul did in his testimony, in his ministry. He shared his testimony repeatedly. Every time he went somewhere, he would say what Jesus did for him. The bottom line in all this is that Jesus' resurrection is established historic fact. Again, not a myth that developed over time, not a grand lie invented by just a handful of people. This wasn't a massive hallucination, not a delusion experienced by grieving friends. This is a fact fully vetted by all available historical and legal methods available at the time. And it's a fact that stands the test of time even to this very day. There is no event in antiquity that has more evidence in its favor than the resurrection of Jesus. The eyewitness accounts are numerous. And neither the Jews nor the Romans could disprove it. They wanted to. The easiest thing in the world would have been for the Jews to produce a body. After all, we know the exact grave in which Jesus had been laid. It was a member of the Jewish Sanhedrin that had requested the body. They knew where Joseph of Arimathea's tomb would have been. A 15-minute walk to the tomb could have destroyed Christianity before it was ever born. And it never happened. What did happen instead? Well, thousands of Jerusalem Jews gave their lives to Christ within weeks of his resurrection. The Jewish leadership railed against the apostles, but they never once contested them. The gospel message spread by the early church turned the world upside down. The only way that any of this happens is through a factual resurrection. And that's exactly what it is. So what does all this mean? It means that if Jesus is truly risen from the dead, it means that he truly is God. And if Jesus is truly risen from the dead, it means everything that he said is true. It means that if he's really risen from the dead, it means he has a power to change lives. Paul offers himself as living proof, and that's the last section we look at, is that the resurrection is transformational. It's transformational, it's foundational, it's historical, it's transformational. Verse 9, for I am the least of the apostles who am not worthy to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. This is not false humility on the part of Paul. When Paul needed to assert his apostolic authority, he didn't hesitate to do so. But he never forgot his past. He knew he was forgiven of his past, but he never forgot it. Paul was not merely a skeptic in regards to Christianity. Before he came to faith, he was steadfastly dedicated to its destruction. As a young Pharisee, Paul, who was then known as Saul, he persecuted the church of God. He hunted Christians in and around Jerusalem, and he was so successful at his task that he received permission to go a long ways away up to Damascus in Syria to do exactly the same thing. He had a fervent desire to purify the people of God in his mind. And to the pre-Christian Saul, that meant purging out the Christians whom he viewed as heretics. That's when the resurrected Jesus stopped him in his tracks and changed his life. Paul describes it in his own words, Acts 22, 6 through 8. Now it happened as I journeyed and came near Damascus at about noon, suddenly a great light from heaven shone around me. And I fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to me, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? So I answered, who are you, Lord? And he said to me, I am Jesus of Nazareth, whom you are persecuting. Can you imagine the shock? Can you imagine the horror that falls on his heart as he comes to grips with the fact that the Lord he thought he was serving, he was actually persecuting. He wasn't purifying the people of God. He was murdering those who are beloved by God. I can't imagine a feeling more gut-wrenching. Paul would think surely he deserved death. He would deserve worse if it was possible. How could God ever use a person like this? Much less, how could God ever love a person like this? Yet he did, verse 10, but by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. Paul received grace. The love of the resurrected Jesus changed Paul from a murderer to an apostle, changed him from the chief of all sinners to a humble servant of the living God. Grace transformed Paul from the inside out, and this least of the apostles was able to make a bigger impact for the kingdom than the original 12 put together. Now, that's not a boast. That's a fact. Most of the 12 apostles aren't named anywhere outside the gospel accounts, and some are barely mentioned inside the gospel accounts. And out of those, Peter and John did a lot, but not even they traveled as far and wide as Paul did. Paul had a minimum of 3 missionary journeys. Some scholars think that he took a 4th after the close of the book of Acts. He personally planted dozens of churches. He underwent incredible suffering along the way. He received stonings, robberies. He was involved in shipwrecks. He had all kinds of hardships. And that doesn't even begin to mention the number of letters that he wrote under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, which provides an incredible percentage of our New Testament. The labor that he accomplished for Jesus by the grace of God was abundant indeed. And how is that all possible? Grace. He says it. Grace. 3 times in the single sentence, he says the word grace. Because that's the root of everything that he was. He encountered the living Jesus and he received grace. Just seeing Jesus is an act of grace. Then he was forgiven of his sin. Well, that's grace. Being empowered and called into the ministry, that's grace. Being empowered to go everywhere that he did, that's grace. Having the strength to endure what he did, that's grace. Writing under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, that's grace. Paul was bathed in grace. Everything he did was because of the grace of God. And so it is with you and me. What we do as believers, we do because we've received and experienced grace from the living Lord Jesus. Were you forgiven of your sins? That's grace. Were you filled with the Holy Spirit? That's grace. Have you received blessings from God? There's grace. Are you blessed when you read his word, you spend time in prayer, you experience his presence? That's grace. Are you a different person than you once were? You know you've got an eternal future. That's grace. All you are and all you have as a Christian is due to the grace of Christ. It is because the resurrected Lord Jesus has loved you, interacted with you, and showered you with his blessing. It is grace. Now, does this mean every day is a bed of roses for the Christian? Absolutely not. It wasn't for Paul. When Paul suffered, he truly suffered. But he never suffered alone. The Lord Jesus was always with him, just like the Lord Jesus is always with us. When we receive him as Lord, we receive him as Lord forever. He will never leave us. He'll never forsake us. His Spirit indwells us, and his promise is to keep us, to complete his work within us, and receive us to himself. Again, all due to grace. Verse 11, therefore, whether it was I or they, so we preach, and so you believed. So it didn't matter who preached the gospel to the Corinthians as long as it was preached. It didn't matter what other issues the Corinthians had so long as they believed. Without this gospel of the resurrected Lord Jesus, nothing else mattered. This is how they would live in the grace of God, and it was vital that they stand within it. Do you stand in the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ? You've heard it proclaimed. You've heard the testimony of Christians through the ages. Do you believe? Understand that the resurrection of Jesus is not a nice truth to just file away in the back of our minds as a bit of Bible trivia. It's not something to check off our mental checklist of, you know, things we're supposed to believe when we walk into church. The resurrection of Jesus is absolutely key to his gospel, which means it's absolutely key to our salvation. Without it, we have nothing. Later on in this letter, Paul goes on to write 1 Corinthians 15:15-17, yes, and we're found false witnesses of God because we've testified of God that he has raised up Christ, whom he did not raise up, if in fact the dead do not rise, put forth the hypothetical. For if the dead do not rise and Christ is not risen, and if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. It doesn't get more critical than that. Without the resurrection of Jesus, there's no forgiveness of sin. There's no Christianity. Beloved, we must stand in the gospel. We must stand firm in the truth that Jesus is indeed the Christ, crucified for our sins, buried in the tomb, risen on the third day, witnessed by others. This is the core of our faith, the means through which we receive the grace of God, our promise of forgiveness and eternal life. Don't be swayed from it. Don't allow the skepticism of this age to shake you from it. Don't allow the world and its pressure to push it aside. This is our gospel. This is the power of God to change the world. So let me ask you again, have you believed this good news? Have you believed upon the resurrected Jesus Christ, receiving him as your Lord and Savior? And if you haven't, there's no better time to do so than Resurrection Sunday. Right. On the day that we celebrate Jesus' resurrected life, receive that same life for yourself. Turn to God, ask forgiveness for your sin, and trust yourself to Jesus, believing that gospel truth of him. Those who do receive life, that is his blessed guarantee. And you can do that as we pray. Father, thank you so much for Jesus coming for us. Thank you, Lord, that you allowed your son to put on flesh and dwell among us, become sin on our behalf, and die the death that we deserved on the cross. Thank you that he endured that for us. But I thank you most of all that he didn't stay dead. He was victorious over death, proven by his resurrection. Thank you that it is historical. Thank you that we do not have to believe blindly, but we can know that it is a fact your son rose from the grave. He is alive today. And I thank you, Lord, for every person in this building who's already put his or her faith in Christ to be saved. And Lord, for any who have not, for any whose, you know, Christianity is just a nice thing every so often, or they're not really sure if they believe, draw them to yourself right now. Reveal to them the dire necessity they have for the grace of Jesus Christ, for the assurance of eternal salvation. Then help them right now put their faith in the living God, responding to Jesus' promise to save. Lord, you give them the words they need in their heart to turn away from their sins and to surrender themselves to Jesus, giving him their lives for Jesus to be their Lord. Then give them the assurance that you have heard and that you answer. Lord, we thank you and we praise you. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.